Well, hello. Hey, I just rolled in from the Elgin campus, and I had so much fun meeting people out in the lobby that I kept staying and staying. I forget, boy, I've got to drive and make it down here, and you guys had such beautiful weather for me today, so thank you for that. You know, sometimes I complain about the weather up here. This weather is awesome. Last night, I started my sermon off saying, hey, this is incredible weather. I got halfway through my sermon. No lie, it started hailing here at Rolling Meadows. And I mean, it was so loud, people thought the Lord was returning. And so I took back what I had said about the weather last night. But it's great to be back with you. I'm excited because I get to be with you all 2 weekends in a row, which I have never got to do. So it's going to be fun for me. I came in on Thursday. I got to attend that meeting at the Niles campus. And I got to hear that exciting announcement from Greg Bradshaw and from Mo and from the elders about that campus becoming independent. And that was at the heart of the original decision years ago, back in 2004, when Niles first began. And so I applaud the elders and the church leadership team for following through on that initial commitment. And it sure seems like the timing is right for that. And I know Pastor Mo is going to do an awesome job of just continuing to lead. And I'm also pumped up about the Act Like Men conference. I just was told just a few minutes ago that with some more registrations today, it's gone over 600 men, and it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm sliding up there next week on Sunday for that, and I'm very excited about it. So, a lot of introductory remarks. Now we're gonna jump in. A couple years ago, my wife Beth and I, we were on vacation in Texas for a few days, and I had some free time, and so I went and found a public golf course, and I went to the pro shop to see if they could kind of work me in. And I said, how much does it cost if I played 18 holes and I took a cart? And the guy looked at me, he said, well, he said, since you're 60 years old, you get a 20% discount. Well, at the time, I was 55 years old. So not the things that you want to hear, and it really bothered me. I wanted to strangle him with my Fleetwood Mac belt that I had on. But I chose not to, and then I got to think, you know, maybe what happened is he saw my salt and pepper, goatee. That's probably what it was. And that the gray pieces here, it just emotes wisdom. And so I'm certain that's what it was. So I tried to maintain my composure, and I kind of chuckled, and I said, well, I said, you're wrong in your assumption. I'm only 55, so charge me the full price. And he was taken back by my startling statement as he studied my receding hairline. And as I walked outside, I began to reflect and realize my mistake. For if I truly possess the wisdom of a 60-year-old, when he said, since you're 60, you get a 20% discount, I should have just said, wow, how do you do this? You're amazing. And without ever uttering an untruth, I would have received the discount and I could have given more money to the Lord's work, right? But instead, I had proudly corrected his mistake, paid the full price, and then went out and, in my frustration, played the worst round of golf that I ever had, you know? As soon as the round was over, I went to IHOP. Y'all ever go to IHOP? IHOP gives a discount when you're 55, okay? 10% off. So I sat down there, and I got the discounts, and the woman, the waitress, said to me, you don't look 55. And I said, thank you. And she said, you look 60. So I give up. It was not that great of a vacation, all right? Now, we don't like it when who we are or something about us is questioned. And no one enjoys when there is a case of mistaken identity. It's painful for us. It's an affront to who we are at the core of our being. Don't you know who I am? Don't you know what I've done? It's the coach who doesn't realize that you have been working out and you've put on 20 pounds of muscle since last season. It's the potential new boss who's unaware of the awards that you've won and the success that you have experienced in the industry. It's your mother-in-law who's unimpressed with who you are and what you do because no one is good enough for her child. And we find it frustrating when people don't recognize us for who we are or for what we've done. I wonder if Jesus ever felt that way. After feeding 5,000 people from a boy's sack lunch, after raising a young girl from the dead, after turning water into wine, I wonder if he ever got frustrated when, after those miraculous moments, people still doubted his deity. I wonder if he ever was tempted just to say, "Don't you know who I am? Don't you know what I've done?" And I wonder if he was ever tempted to look at skeptics and people who doubted him and say the same thing I said to that golf employee: "Well, you're wrong in your assumption." So here's what I want to do for today and for next weekend, and that is I want us to take a look in the Gospels, and we're going to see what Jesus Christ, what makes him so distinctive from every other world leader, from every religious figure of all time. And if you're here today and you are investigating Christianity, I hope that you'll begin to see why, as followers of Jesus, we claim and believe with all of our hearts that he is God's living Son. And that the heart of Christianity is knowing who Jesus is and what he's done. It's realizing his identity and believing in his deity. And those are foundational to our faith. Jesus Christ was different than any other man who has ever lived. His life of love changed the course of history forever. And through these glimpses that we see of Jesus and how he loved and lived, we will be reinforced in our Christian beliefs, and we'll learn from the example that Jesus set for us through his distinctive life as we dig deeper into the details of the divine. Now, sometimes people will say to me, they'll say, "Well, Dave, you know, I mean, but all roads really lead to heaven, so it doesn't really matter what we believe." Or people will oftentimes say this: "Well, there are a lot of good belief systems out there. As long as you're sincere in what you believe, that's really all that matters." But Jesus didn't agree with that. And that's why Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 6, he said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So he didn't buy into the notion that believe whatever you want, as long as you're sincere in your beliefs, everything will be okay. In fact, when people will say, "Well, you know, all roads lead to heaven," doesn't make any sense logically even to say that. How can you have competing views with different outcomes and both of them still be correct? So we are called to evaluate and to investigate who Jesus is. That is our responsibility. And when we do, we will discover that there are some key differences with Christianity and with many other religions. And these aren't small, insignificant differences. These are big issues. These are big rock issues. Many religions make claims and boasts of what their leader can do. But only Jesus can. Only Jesus can deliver on those promises. So let's begin today. We're going to divide this into two different camps. Here's the first one. Jesus' teachings were countercultural. And if you've looked at the Gospels or ever read the Gospels, you're well aware of the fact that Christ's teachings were quite countercultural. They always went against the grain. He taught his followers that they would need to go against the flow of culture. Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, he says, "Broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many will find it. But," he says, "narrow is the path that leads to eternal life." And he says, "only a few will find it." So if you are going to be different than the world, you're not going to follow the crowd. You're going to march the beat of a different drum. You're going to head in a different direction. And so the challenge for us is to say, I will live a countercultural life, and I will go against the grain, and I will go on that narrow path, the one that is less traveled. So let's look at some different categories where we see Christ's teaching being countercultural. Here's the first one on serving. Serving is seen differently through Christ's eyes than it is the world's eyes. We've been taught that our goal is to get to the top of the ladder, to climb the ladder of success, to walk over the top of anybody you have to get there. And then once you get there, people will be there waiting on your beck and call. They will respond to any of your needs. And it sounds really good, but you just need to know Jesus didn't place a high priority on that. And in fact, it's not his ultimate goal at all. It seems that his way was different. It was as if the measure of someone's greatness is not the number of servants that they have, but rather it's the number of people that they serve. It's inverted. It's upside down. Listen to what Jesus says to the disciples. If you want, turn to Matthew chapter 20. We're going to look at several passages in the gospel. But in Matthew chapter 20, Jesus is talking to the disciples, and this is right after they have been arguing over who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom and who would have the chief seats when Jesus came into his kingdom, who would sit in his right and his left-hand side. And we pick it up in Matthew chapter 20, verse 25. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." There are three different places in the New Testament where Jesus says why he came, and he refers to himself as the Son of Man when he does that in each of those three instances. This is one of those three. One of the reasons why Jesus came was the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. That's why he came. Anytime you come across something like that, that's a good motivator for us to say, well, if that's why Jesus came, then that would be a good reason for me to look at my existence of being a servant. Jesus came to serve others. And he says there are a lot of people who will try to lord over their position or their power or their role over other people. He says a lot of people will try to lord it over. Not so with you. In other words, as a Christ follower, you are to be distinctive. You are to be different. And the world should be able to sense and see that difference. We're not fighting our way to the top and climbing over the top of others. We're lifting one another up. We're serving one another. I was here last night worshiping, and I told some family members that it's so cool when I'm at Harvest just to see the way you all serve one another. And after the service was over, I just saw different people reaching out to folks that were visiting, or they were maybe a guest of someone else, or maybe they were a person that someone may tend to just overlook. They were a broken person. They were a person that was dealing with some special need. And just to see you all and this flock go out of their way and love on those people. That's a picture of Jesus Christ. That's a picture of love. It's a picture of service. Back in the 1960s, there was an oil executive that went on a trip overseas to a third world country. While he was there, he went to an area where there was a leprosy outbreak, and there was a missionary woman that was there, and she was washing and cleaning the wound of a leper. And of course, this is a highly contagious infection. And this wealthy executive walked past, and he stayed as far away as he possibly could, and he looked down at the woman who was wiping the wounds and said, "I wouldn't do that for $1 million. And the woman didn't even look up at him. She just kept gently rubbing the wound, and she said, "Neither would I. Neither would I." There are things that you will do as a Christ follower that others won't do. There are things that you will do that years ago, before you became a Christ follower, you wouldn't have even considered it. Why is that? It's because you're trying to look for those opportunities to live a countercultural life that shows people who Jesus Christ is and the difference. So we don't serve for money. We don't serve for attention. We serve out of love and to plant a seed that could draw someone closer to Christ. Let's look at another topic and see Jesus' views. Let's look at giving. We've been raised in a society that puts a high premium on keeping more so than giving. And we try to feed our carnal desires, and we pursue more purchases, and we accumulate more stuff. We think that we will be better and feel better about ourselves if we are in acquisition mode rather than in relinquishing mode. And so we try to keep up with the Joneses. And discontentment breeds impatience. We think, I've got to have this, and I've got to have it now. We live in this microwave age. We want our stuff, and we want it as quickly as we can get it. And if we're not careful, rather than focusing on Christ, we can begin to compare with others what it is we have. I sometimes struggle with that, and it really doesn't even matter what the area is. It can just pop up like, oh boy, I wish I had that. Or somebody else got that. Now that would be really cool to have. I wish I had something like they have. I was on a flight not too long ago, and the flight attendant was making her way through like she always does, and she came to my row, and she said, hey, would you like some peanuts? I said, I love peanuts. I said, that'd be great. So she gave me a small bag of peanuts, and emphasis on small, right, if you've flown recently. So she gives me this little bag of peanuts, and I start to open it. About that time, she asks the guy on the other side of the aisle. She said, would you like some peanuts? He said, I'd love some. He said, in fact, make it two bags. She said, okay. She gave him two bags, and she moved on. Now I'm looking at my bag of peanuts, and I look over at this dude. He's got two bags. And I mean, for the next few minutes, he is just, you know, ostentatious. And as he's eating, you know, he's got 12 and I've got 6, right? And I mean, he's just smirking and he's confident. And I don't know if he really felt that way, but that's the way it appeared to me. And it just was so hard on me. And the whole time I'm sitting there, I'm thinking, why didn't I ask for two? Why didn't I ask for two? He's got twice as many as I have. Well, for about 15 minutes, I was frustrated. I stewed over that. About that time, the flight attendant, they began the descent. She's making her final pass through, and she's bringing the cart back by. Just as she goes past me, I go, ma'am, I said, you think I could get some more peanuts? She said, sure, and she hands me a bag. I said, let's make it two. She said, okay, and she gives me two bags, and she heads off, and the guy over there, he was so fired up, and I just enjoyed those. It's a come from behind victory. I won 18-12, right? We love to keep score. We keep score, whether it's possessions, paychecks, or peanuts. And we just want to make certain that we don't miss out, and we want to have. And so we hoard, and we keep, and we stockpile, and we say, mine, it's mine. And Jesus wants us to live where our hands hold on to the things of this world quite loosely. And so whatever you're blessed with, whether it's little or a lot, you just begin to share it. And you see a need and you meet it and you go out of your way. Why do you do that? Because you look like Christ when you do that. In Acts chapter 20, verse 35, one of the few times that there's a quote from Jesus in the book of Acts, Jesus says, it is more blessed to give than to receive. You say, well, that sounds strange. Try giving and tell me if it still sounds strange. At Christmas time, when you're asked, what was your favorite gift? Oftentimes, you will not talk about a gift that you received. Instead, you'll talk about a gift that you gave. And it's because you put some effort into it, you put some work into it, some thought into it, and you derived more joy from watching them open that and receive that gift than you did from something that you received. And so Christ is asking us to be unselfish with others, to view our resources as a way to make a kingdom difference. If you allow money to define you, eventually it will destroy you. Let's look at another of Christ's countercultural views, and that is on the topic of praying. I think sometimes we miss the intent of prayer because we become consumed with how we sound to others when we pray publicly. Or we'll say, I don't know what to pray, so I don't know how that might come out. Or maybe we'll say, you pray in your small group or at a family reunion or wherever it might be, or at around mealtime at a table in your house. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in how it's going to come out and what we say that we forget that prayer is simply a conversation between you and God. That's what it is. Just as when you read God's word, you're getting to know the author. And when you pray to God, what you're doing is you're having a conversation with him. You're getting to know him. And so don't get so wrapped up in how other people perceive what it is that you pray or say. If so, we've misplaced the emphasis. Jesus said this in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. He said, when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door. Pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Jesus is saying, don't worry so much about how others perceive you or if people think that you are really spiritual. Jesus realizes that the longer that you are a Christian, the more tempting that becomes, because within all of us, there is this Pharisaical tendency that we gravitate toward. We like it when people think that we are spiritually superior to others. We like that feeling. But Jesus says when you get to that point in any area, but especially in the area of prayer, he says you've missed the meaning. You have paralyzed the power and the potency of prayer by making it about you instead of about him. Prayer is all about him. Let's look at one last area of Christ's countercultural views, all right? And that is on the topic of life and death. Life and death. Jesus says in Matthew 16, verse 25, he says, "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will find it." So it's a backwards thinking. It's different than the way the world thinks. It's counterintuitive. Whoever wants to save their life must be willing to lose it. You know, I look out. This is a younger crowd at this service. And when I was your age in 20s and 30s, you kind of feel like you're invincible, and you feel like, oh, I'm going to live for the rest of my life. I'm going to live till I'm 80 or 85 years old. Well, I hope you do, and maybe you will. But in 35 years of ministry, I've done countless funerals for teens and 20s and 30s. And we have no promise of tomorrow. James says that we're like a mist that is here today and gone tomorrow. We're like a vapor in the eternal scheme of when we move from this world into eternity. That's why we have to live this life with the next one in mind. Rich Mullins had a song out years ago, said, "Live like you'll die tomorrow, die knowing you'll live forever." What if every day you lived with just no regrets? When the Lord calls you home, I don't have regrets from what I should have been doing the last week of my life. I'm ready. That's why the Apostle Paul came to that conclusion. He said, "For me to live is Christ, but to die is gain." So we don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds the future, and we're gonna trust in him. And all of us will find ourselves at different times in tense situations, in trying times. Sometimes they may even be those life or death moments. And when those unexpected times occur, you will be less stressed if you've lived this life with the next in mind and you followed the countercultural teachings of your Lord and Savior. When Jesus Christ faced adversity and even an unjust death, he did so with courage and he did so with love like no other. I mean, think about it. You talk about counterintuitive and countercultural. He has a chance to save his own life. He's been arrested, he is tied, he's been beaten, and he's brought before all these different people, Annas, Caiaphas. Finally, he ends up before Pilate, the governor. You remember what happens in John chapter 19? They keep saying all these things to him, you know, "Say something in your defense, say something in your defense," and Jesus doesn't say anything. Why doesn't he? Well, I think for a couple of reasons. One, he knows he's got to save us from our sins, and if he's let off and gets freed, he can't do that. But secondly, it's a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy that says, "As a lamb before his shears is silent, so the Son of Man spoke not a word." And so he stood there and took it. Jesus could handle any question that the Pharisees threw at him. He could always turn the table. He's the one who created the mouth. So of course he could have talked his way out of it. He could have done anything, but he didn't. He remained silent. And finally, he speaks up. John chapter 19, verse 10. Pontius Pilate gets right up in his face, and he's so infuriated that Jesus hasn't said anything back to him. And Pilate starts to throw around his power. He looks at Jesus square in the eyes. He says, "Don't you realize that I have the power to either free you or to crucify you?" And that's when Jesus opens his mouth. And he says, "You would have no power over me were it not given to you from above. What he was saying was this: make no mistake, Pilate, you are not taking my life. I am giving my life. And there's a huge difference. He realized that he had to have a countercultural approach to life in order for us to have the hope of eternal life. And that's how much Jesus loved you. He kept his mouth silent. He didn't say anything. He didn't defend himself. He took death so that you could have life. Not only were his teachings countercultural, but briefly, let's also realize, here's a second point, Jesus' ministry had authority. His ministry had authority. You know, we know very little about Christ's training or about his upbringing and his growing up years. All we know is that he probably grew up like a normal Jewish boy, where he was immersed in the Old Testament scriptures at a very young age. But something happened when he began his ministry at the age of 30 and he began to teach. Something amazing happened whenever he would teach. Why would people sit and listen rather than stand and leave? Why would multitudes sit on a mountainside so mesmerized that they missed a meal? How does that happen? Well, Jesus was challenging. He was convicting. He motivated them to want to change. He gave them hope. And yet he never lessened or lowered his expectations. In fact, all throughout Scripture, what does he do? He elevates the standard from what the Old Testament said. He was always elevating the standard of expectation. So why did all these people flock to him and want to listen to him? What made Jesus' teaching stand out from everyone else's? Well, it was his authority. Jesus had authority. I didn't put this next line on your note page, but you may want to jot it down. The one who had created their heart knew how to reach their heart. You know, Jesus was present at the creation of the world in Genesis. That's why it says, let us make man in our own image. Because God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit were all there. And so the one who had created their heart knew how to reach their heart. And that's how he had that authority. We watch a lot of basketball in Kentucky. We don't have a pro team like you all do, but we have college teams. And I don't know if you're watching any of the NBA finals, but you'll notice that slam dunks have become rather commonplace. You know, now there's not a game that you watch where there's not a dunk, you know, every 2 minutes or 3 minutes somebody's dunking the ball, right? And so it's become kind of commonplace. But every once in a while, there will be a dunk that stands out from all the rest of them in the game. And what will they do? They will replay it 4 or 5 times. They'll show every different angle of that dunk. And the basketball announcer will always say the same thing. He'll say this. He'll say, he brought it down with authority. Brought it down with authority. What's he saying? He's saying all the other dunks that we've watched in the game were ordinary, but that dunk, that was extraordinary. And that's what happened when Jesus would teach. When Jesus would teach, all the other people had heard other people. They'd say those people were ordinary. But when they saw the authority that he spoke with, they realized that there was something distinct and different that went beyond the inspired content that he shared. There's a phrase that you'll see oftentimes in the Bible, in the Gospels. It says, you have heard it said, but I tell you. And that's Jesus talking, and Jesus is making a reference back to the Old Testament, and now he's going to elevate the standard in the New Testament. You have heard it said, but I tell you, think of it like this. Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount, you have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, if someone strikes you on the right side of the cheek, you turn to them your left as well. And it shows that contrast. You see what Jesus is doing. Jesus is different than every other rabbi and teacher. He is giving them a new teaching. And their teaching was called the rabbi's yoke. It was the rabbi's yoke. Their teaching, their belief system, their philosophy, their worldview. And the rabbi would be known by their unique teaching, and that was called their yoke. But when a rabbi would emerge on the scene with a very different yoke, a different type of teaching, people would travel to hear it, and they would tell other people about it, and they would spread the word. But Jesus had authority that went along with that different teaching. Think back to this passage. You probably know this one in Matthew chapter 11, where Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." You remember what the next phrase says? Take my yoke upon you. You used to read that and you say, "What in the world does that mean? That doesn't make any sense. Take my yoke upon you." He says, "Take my yoke, take my teachings, take my belief system, and you put that on you." He says, "Because my yoke is easy and my burden is light." You see, a lot of people try to paint Christianity as a big list of rules and restrictions and regulations and all these things that we shouldn't do. And we think, oh, the Christian life is, I can't do this, I can't do that. You know, I don't drink and I don't chew and I don't go with girls who do. You know, it's all these things we don't do, right? But that's not what the Christian life is all about. The Christian life is about the things that you get to do. And these things are freeing. They are fulfilling. They are liberating to you. And Jesus says, that's the yoke that I have for you. It's one that is freeing to you, that changes your life. And because of that, that's what we hold on to. And when the people would hear his teaching, they wanted to spread that to everyone. And when you add that authority in there, it was off the charts. Some of you are probably thinking the same thing that the original 12 disciples were thinking. And that is, why would Jesus want someone like me to be his follower, as messed up as I am? Maybe you've wondered that or thought that. I've thought it a whole bunch. I've thought it this week. Well, if you understand the rabbinical system, the way it worked was that a student would choose a rabbi. And he would go to the rabbi, and that's what they would do. They would go to the rabbi and say, "Hey, I would like you to mentor me. I would like you to be my teacher. I would like to follow you." But that's not the case in what Jesus did. Once again, Jesus inverts it and does it just the opposite. You'll recall with your knowledge of the Gospels that Jesus actually went to each of these guys. Instead of these guys coming to him, Jesus went to each of these guys. And he went to this ragtag team of people, a greedy tax collector, smelly fishermen, two rebellious brothers who were known as the Sons of Thunder. And Jesus went to each of them, 12 in all, and he personally invited each of them to individually follow him. 5 times in the Gospels, it records Jesus saying the words, "Believe in me." 20 times in the Gospels, it records Jesus saying, "Follow me." He invites us to follow him. That's why on the night that Jesus is going to be betrayed and he is arrested, he's talking with his disciples. And in John chapter 15, you remember what he says? It's going to mean more to you now. You remember what Jesus says? He looks at them and says, "You did not choose me." In other words, all the other times, all these other rabbis in town, the student chose that person. The student chose the rabbi. That's not what happened here. So Jesus looks at them with love and says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and I appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last." This rabbi is communicating to his students, "Hey, I believe in you. There is hope. I care about you. I chose you." And things are going to get crazy in the next couple days. I'm going to be crucified. But I'm going to come back from the dead on the third day. I'm going to go to heaven, and you are going to stay behind, and I'm counting on you to perpetuate my yoke, my teaching, these countercultural teachings. I'm counting on you to share that with others because I believe in you. And he could say the same thing to each of us, that he believes in you. In spite of my pride, he still chose me. In spite of your complacency, he still chose you. Listen to Mark chapter 1, verses 23 through 27. "And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, 'What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God.' But Jesus rebuked him, saying, 'Be silent and come out of him.' And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him, and they were all amazed so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." When people saw Christ's miracles and yet still rejected his message, I'm sure their case of mistaken identity was discouraging and frustrating to him. This wasn't some accidental miscalculation of his age. This was the missing the Messiah. It was failing to realize why Jesus had come and who it is that he was. And if you fail to realize why Jesus came and who he was, it will cost you for all eternity. And I don't say that to frighten you. I say that to warn you and to invite you to believe that Jesus is God's living Son. In John chapter 1, verse 14, Jesus says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." And then a little further down in verse 17, "For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." Look at that contrast. We got the law through Moses, we get grace and truth through Jesus Christ. Please don't miss this. At the heart of why Jesus taught with authority was simply this: Jesus was full of grace and truth. And I want to challenge you today. If you are a Christ follower, the best way you can represent Jesus is to be a person who is full of grace and truth. I could point you to plenty of preachers who, it's all grace, everything's grace, you live any way you want to, it's grace, grace, grace. Not a whole lot of holiness or truth. I could point you to a lot of people that are heavy on the truth side, and they shame people, and no one will ever measure up to the expectations that they have because they have no grace. They just drive the truth home. But Jesus was all about grace and truth. You remember in John chapter 8, the woman caught in the act of adultery? Remember that? She's brought before Jesus. He said, the Old Testament says we should stone such a woman. What do you say, Jesus? Jesus says, whichever one of you guys doesn't have any sin in your life, you go ahead and cast the first stone. And they drop their rocks of righteousness intended to stone the lust out of her life, and they slowly walk away one at a time. And Jesus nonchalantly says to the woman, "Where are your accusers?" And she says, "There's no one." And Jesus says, "Then neither do I accuse you." That's grace. Go now and leave your life of sin. That's truth. It takes both of them. And that's what people should be able to sense and see through your life. They should be able to tell that there's something different. Let me close by just telling you about a song that churches used to sing a few decades ago. It was called "Must Jesus Bear the Cross Alone." And the words of it is a song we sing all the time in churches. "Must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone and there's a cross for me." And I realize that the writer was probably trying to stress that we all have a cross that we need to bear, and that Jesus himself tells us that we have to take up our cross daily. But I just have to be honest with you, I still have a disconnect with the song. Because when I read the Gospels and I ask myself that question, "Must Jesus bear the cross alone?" The answer is yes. No one else could do it. He's the only one who could do it. And so sadly and painfully and truthfully, the answer is yes. And he is surrounded at a cross with people hurling insults and shouting at him, all because they don't realize his identity. They just didn't realize who he was. And earlier I said, I wonder if Jesus was frustrated when people failed to realize his deity. I wonder if he ever wanted to look at them and say, "Hey, you guys are wrong in your assumption." I don't know if Jesus ever said that to them, but on that Friday 2,000 years ago, I do know that this is what Jesus did say. He said, "Charge me the full price." And so they did. And the price he paid covered over all of my sins. And he put his arms out, and men nailed 6-inch spikes into his wrists and into his ankles. Why? Because he knew that we couldn't pay for our sins on our own. And so he bore our sins for us. Isaiah, 700 years prior to the crucifixion, said this: he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. Here's what I'm saying. The worst thing that ever happened to Jesus is the best thing that ever happened to you. And you can be free, and you can be forgiven. His yoke is easy. His burden is light. He paved the way for you and me to find faith, to experience forgiveness, and to discover fulfillment. Who can do that? Only Jesus can. Let's pray. Lord, when you come again, there will be no case of mistaken identity. We will know, and everyone will know who you are and why it is that you have come. So, Lord, would you help us to prepare for that day by living with an eternal perspective each day rather than a temporary one? And will you help us to follow your countercultural teachings and walk in a way that brings glory and honor to you? It's in the powerful name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen.